and I can go on and on because down on the same. I really hope you ready. So much grace and favor falling on me. Hallelujah, on me. It's what it do, yeah. Shower down like rain. I really hope.
Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome to our Elevate service here at Full Council Pine Bluff. I hope you're ready because I'm ready to start this new series. It's called Restore. Okay, it's going to be amazing. So go ahead and start texting your friends, family, co-workers, everybody that you know, and hit that share button. Help tonight's message broadcast go all around the world. Meanwhile, I'm going to jump into a few announcements. If you're looking for a way to jumpstart your day, we want to invite you to start your mornings with us on the Prayer Cloud every weekday morning starting at 6 a.m. for a time of prayer and a word from the Lord. Just dial 515-603-3151 and then use the access code 739-842-POUND. Be sure to start your day the right way on the Prayer Cloud. We also want to encourage everyone to join us for our now monthly Ignite prayer call every third Monday of each month at 6:30 p.m. using that same Prayer Cloud number. All right. Now, we want to also tell you about Table Talk with Bishop and Lady J on Thursdays. These talks are always filled with revelation and practical counsel. That's the Prophetic Voice Table Talk on Thursdays at 10:30 a.m. on Lady J's Facebook and Instagram pages. The Watch Zone is a great opportunity for your kids to stay connected to the church while learning and having fun. Lady J hosts these live broadcasts that consist of stories, Bible lessons, and even fun, unique games. So be sure to have your kids to tune in to Facebook every Saturday from 11 to 11:30 a.m. on Full Council Metro Church Facebook page. We're also very excited for our church convocation, 35th church anniversary, and Pastor Appreciation Week. Mark your calendars for December the 3rd through the 6th, and make sure you stay tuned for more details. We are sowers who are always ready to sow, and your continued giving is super, super important at this time. We have three electronic ways to give. You can use PayPal, Givelify, or the Shelby Next app. All of these tools are safe, quick, and easy. Plus, you can access them anytime, anywhere. You can also mail in or drop off your offerings to the church during normal business hours. So for your convenience, find quick links to all of our giving platforms by visiting www.fullcouncil.org and click that Give tab. Now let me ask you a question. Have we connected on social media? If not, be sure to follow Pastor V on Instagram at VTheSaint. On Facebook, search Silas Vincent Johnson, then follow our church on Instagram at Full Council PB, on Facebook by searching Full Council Church Pine Bluff. And don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. Find us on YouTube by searching Full Council Pine Bluff. Don't forget to click that small bell to receive notifications and keep up with all of our new posts and services. Well, that is all I have for you tonight. Until next time, don't forget to tell everyone you see, Full Council Pine Bluff is the place to be. Now, hit that share tab, put some hearts on the screen, and welcome Pastor V.
Well, good evening. It's your boy, Pastor V. Welcome to Elevate. And y'all, we got a special word for you on tonight. I believe that this word is going to be a personal word for you, but I also believe it's going to be a word for the kingdom and the body of Christ. So what I want you to do, if you know somebody that needs restoration in their life, I want you to go ahead and tag them right now. If you're on Facebook, go ahead and tag them right now. Amen, because God has a special word for them. The Bible says over in Psalm 107 and 20, it says, He sent His word to heal us and to deliver us and to heal us from all of our destruction. I'm here to tell you that God has a word for y'all on tonight. Tonight we're going to start a wonderful series called Restore. Oh my God, this is going to be so good. And so y'all, let's go ahead and pray. Father, I thank you for this word on tonight. Holy Spirit, use these lips of clay. I ask you to think through my mind and speak through my lips. I decrease that you may increase. I step back that you may step forward. I thank you that your word will go forth unhindered and unchecked. God, I thank you right now that you will get all the glory and the honor, amen, for every turnaround that we experience because of this word spoken on tonight. I thank you that your people have ears anointed to hear. I rebuke every spell of witchcraft and sorcery and anything that's been worked against them to muffle, amen, to muffle the clarity that you would have them to have on tonight. Have your way in Jesus' name. Amen. Now listen, y'all, let's make our confession over the word tonight. Say this with me. Say, this is my Bible. It's God's holy word. I am what it says I am. I can do what it says I can do. I already have what it says I have. Tonight I will be taught the word of the living God. Faith will come. Faith to overcome. Faith to receive. Faith as a defense. Faith will come because faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Tonight my mind will be transformed. Therefore my life will be transformed and I will never be the same. Never, ever, 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 ever. And ever, in Jesus' name, amen. So if you got your Bible, I want you to turn over to Psalms 23. And y'all know this scripture, amen, it's very familiar, amen. But we're going to use this scripture tonight to go ahead and get started with this series. God is about to restore your life, amen. You're getting ready to laugh again. Ah, my God. You're getting ready to experience relationships again. Hallelujah. Your life is about to be put back together in a way. I see it happening for you. However, y'all, there's a way, there's a path to it. Amen. So this is going to be prophetic tonight. Hallelujah. But at the same time, there's going to be some teaching. And so y'all know how the scripture starts. It says over here in Psalm 23, it says, the Lord is my shepherd. Hallelujah. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside the still waters. Look here in verse number 3. And he restores my soul. He restores my soul. What's so awesome about this passage is this passage, amen, of course, is God-breathed, but it was written by one of the greatest kings that ever lived, amen, by the name of King David. And y'all know King David had a life full of ups and downs. Come on, somebody. And so when he wrote this passage, many people or theologians believe he wrote it around 34 or 35. He wrote this passage with a full understanding of how important his soul was to his outcome, how important his soul was to his victory and to his winning. We're talking about a young man that experienced rejection from the first time we ever heard about him, when they were having a meeting and about who was going to be king and who was going to be chosen. He wasn't even invited to the meeting, but how many of you know he came out on top? Come on, somebody. And even when he fought Goliath, y'all know the story, his brothers made fun of him. His brothers were calling him arrogant. His brothers were calling him prideful. And even King Saul, y'all know, you know the story of King Saul and how King Saul made fun of him and tried to make him feel small, but he did not let that get him down. And then we can go over into how Saul ended up turning on him, but he did not allow Saul's behavior to get him down. And even when he was dealing with Saul, y'all remember the story of Ziklag. Come on, somebody. somebody when he lost everything. He lost all of his homeboy stuff. He lost all of his follower stuff. He lost respect from them. But how many of you know David encouraged himself? Come on, somebody, in the Lord. And y'all know the story. He recovered all. David made mistakes just like every last one of us make mistakes. Come on now. And y'all know how he slept with Bathsheba. And that mistake that he made with Bathsheba, amen, it began to affect his life and his reign and even the nation. I mean, it even led to a civil war later on in the nation. But even outside of the nation, on a more personal level, are y'all following me right now? Even on a more personal level, he had incest. Oh my God, in his family. His son turned on him. How many of y'all know that David had a dysfunctional family? Matter of fact, David's family put the funk in dysfunctional. Come on, somebody. But through it all, ooh, Jesus, David made it. He made it out. Through it all, David ended up winning. I remember even when he lost his son because of the sin that he had with Bathsheba, God came and encouraged him and said, David, that baby's going to die, but you don't die with the baby. Get up and make another baby. In other words, David understood the power of soul restoration. Many times when we talk about restore, and many times when we talk about restoration, we like to see manifestations on the outside. We like to see things just come together automatically, but that's not God's way. The way God works is from the inside out. The way God works is from the inside out. You can find this over in 3 John chapter 1 and verse number 2, where he says that my prosperity and my health is relative to the development of my soul. Y'all know what the scripture says. He says, I will that you prosper and you be in health even as your soul prospers. And so tonight we're going to focus on the soul. What is my soul? My soul is my mind, my will, my intellect, and my emotions. Ah, my God. And so God is letting me know that I will have prosperity, I will have good health relative to the development of my mind, my will, my intellect, and my emotions. Tonight, we're going to focus the most on our emotions. Ah, my God. Because when I look at the emotions is a state of mind. Jesus, your emotions will make or break you. Ah, my God. When we start talking about emotions, we have joy, but we also have sadness. Come on, somebody. We have love, but we also have fear. I can look through the whole spectrum of emotions, and I can determine by looking at your state of mind where you're going to end up being. And so David says, you restore my soul. Can you imagine when David was losing everything and all kind of chaos and rejection was happening all around him, of the potential of being down, the potential of being depressed, the potential of being in fear, the potential of being shamed, the potential of being guilty. But David did not fall for that. David understood that my life goes where my soul goes. And so when I look at the soul, I also can look at the mind. The Bible says that my transformation does not come from me being saved. My transformation does not come from some kind of sporadic event that will happen on the outside of me. The Bible says that my transformation comes from the renewing of my mind. And so as we begin to focus on the soul tonight, you're getting ready to see some things, amen, about you. Come on, somebody, that you might have to tweak. You're going to see some things about you that you might have to shift. Because when I look at restoration, even from a prophetic view, over in Joel chapter 2, when it talks about how God restored the years. Come on, somebody. Well, Peter talked about that over in Acts chapter 2. And I don't think it's a coincidence that after that chapter, over in chapter 3, that Peter had told the people, y'all need to repent. amen, for a time of refreshing. That word repent means to change my mind. Then I can skip over to 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse number 14. He says, if my people who were called by my name, come on now, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways or repent, he said, then I will hear from heaven and I will heal their land. Right now, in the mouth of two or three witnesses, we're finding out that restoration will start with the renewing of our mind. Restoration will start in what we're doing with our souls. I'm here to tell you tonight that God is about to restore your soul. And as you submit, and as you surrender, and as you allow God to work on your soul, you're getting ready to see things come back to life. You're getting ready to see your career come back to life. You're getting ready to receive relationships come back to life. You're getting ready to see your finances shift and come back to life. You're getting ready to see favor restored. You're going to see your health restored. Listen, y'all, you're going to see this nation restored. You're going to see the church restored. How many of y'all are ready for restoration? If this is you, I want you to put an amen up on the screen and give God some glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I think that was a heck of an introduction. And so when I begin to look at the soul, the mind, the will, the intellect, and the emotions, I begin to find out that the intellect, amen, will begin to impact your emotions. I also found out that your emotions can also impact your intellect. Has anybody ever heard the term that your emotions will cloud your judgment? Has anybody ever got wrapped up in their emotions where they did something that they wish they could take back? Come on, somebody. Oh my God, I don't know how many times that we have allowed our emotions to get the best of us. But tonight we get ready to break this thing down like a Philadelphia lawyer. Come on, somebody. And as we begin to align our emotions, not with the society, not with what we've been raised, not what we've been raised to do, not how we've been trained, but we're getting ready to align our emotions with the Word of God. So let's go to the beginning. Turn over here to Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3. 2020 got the best of a lot of us. But many of us were having problems before 2020. Many of us experienced loss and heartbreak before 2020. Some of us need restoration from things that happened in the 80s. Some of us need restoration for things that happened in the 90s. Some of you, it's the 70s. It's things that have been lost. Come on, somebody. Dreams that have been lost, and we need to find out how to get it back. So when I look on the emotion scale, I found out that the lowest you can ever get emotionally is the emotion of shame. The devil loves to play the shame game. He knows the power of shame. He uses shame as a weapon to skew your intellect, to cause you to make decisions that are in contradiction to your restoration. He uses shame, are y'all following me tonight, as a weapon to keep you oppressed and suppressed. He uses shame as a weapon to cause you to run from where you need to be running to, and to run to where you need to be running from. Shame. It's the lowest, most negative emotion that you can experience. Because it's from shame that all kinds of demises and settling and defeat begin to manifest. When you are walking in shame, it affects your expectations, where you begin to think that you don't deserve anymore what God has provided for you. Shame. I messed up. Shame. I made a wrong decision. Shame. I married the wrong person. Shame. I spoke the wrong words. Shame. My business went under. Shame. I've been rejected. Shame. I got looked over. Shame. I can talk to you all day about the shame that all of us have experienced. Look like a fool because I gave my life to a man or to a woman, and they left me for somebody else, and they stuck me with children, and they left me halfway widowed, and it just brought shame into my life, and I don't want to go through this again. And so instead of running to the promise, I'm running from the promise, and I'm running into a place and a life and a state of mind that's affecting every other aspect of my life. Shame did not start with you. Shame did not start when you made your mistake. Shame causes you to cover up the truth and to cover up your mistakes by which God cannot work on you. He cannot fix what needs to be fixed. He's already lined up people that have the intellect and the resources to help you to get back on your feet, but your shame is keeping you from running to that help. That's why he said over in the scripture where he says that you can come boldly to the throne of grace because God has dealt with your shame. Genesis chapter 3. And y'all know the story. Is this okay already? Over in verse number 6, and y'all know the story. Well, let's just look at verse number 8, and y'all know the story. It's when God told Adam and Eve not to eat of a certain tree, and he placed them in a beautiful garden, and man was not living in any form of negative emotions. But all of a sudden, a tempter came. A tempter that had already been put to shame because iniquity got in his heart. And the Bible talks about over in Ezekiel how this particular entity was perfect in all of his ways. Come on, somebody. He had nothing to be shamed about. But the Bible says iniquity was found in his heart. And he decided that he would exalt himself above God. He decided that he was too big and too beautiful and too perfect for God. And he decided to exalt himself above God's definition of order, above God's definition of perfection, above God's definition of position. And he fell. Has anybody ever heard the term misery loves company? Have anybody ever heard the term that hurt people? And you can find out people that are really hurt because they're fault finders. They're always looking for you to make a mistake because their shame is misery. Their shame is miserable, and they want you to feel what they're feeling. And right now we're dealing with a nation of ha-ha and a nation of you're a loser and a nation where we're making fun of people and we're using the very weapon that Satan is using to bring about our demise on each other. There's no restoration where you're playing the shame game. And so over here in Genesis chapter 8, he says, Adam had heard the sound of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord. They hid themselves. They ran from what they should be running to. Come on, somebody. And they hid in the trees and in the garden, and the Lord called to Adam and said, where are you? And so he said, I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. Now, what I want you to see here is before fear got in, shame took place. It was the shame that was cultivating the fear. You're afraid to start over. You're afraid to get in another relationship. You're afraid to ever step out on another project. You're afraid to ever do whatever God has called you to do because you're still dealing with the shame of the last, watch this phrase I'm getting ready to use, the last illusion or perception of defeat. And so y'all know the story. Y'all know the story. And he said, I was naked. I was exposed. I was vulnerable. I was without a covering. I don't understand why nobody has my back. I'm sitting out here in the open. So I had to protect myself. Woo! I'm getting ready to go deeper. I had to protect my ministry. I couldn't admit that I prophesied. I couldn't admit that I lied. I couldn't admit that I missed God. I couldn't let y'all look at me in a place that I didn't want y'all to look at me. And so I hid myself. God was like, I want to restore you, Adam. Don't run from the restoration. We can holler restoration all day long, but at the same time, running from the restoration. This is why he said, confess your sin. Don't lie about it. Confess it. That's the only way I can forgive you and cleanse you. I need you to be up front. I don't need anything hid because the only reason why you hide and you cover up and you perpetuate the lie is because you're walking in a state of mind that's affecting your decision making. Oh, this is good. I'm just getting started. This is going to be a heck of a series. Because if God was to give you a new marriage in this state of mind, you wouldn't do nothing but mess it up. If God did give you the new business and give you the business and the ministry and put you right back in the place where you fell from, you wouldn't do nothing but mess it up. That's why God told Adam and Eve, y'all can't stay in the garden unless you eat of the tree of life and remain in this same state. The state of mind that you're in right now is not God's will for your life. David, you messed up, you lost the baby, but your life is not over. Woo, there's some good stuff right here. And so the Bible says, and he said, who told you you were naked? I got to drop some revelation. I got 22 minutes. I got to drop this revelation on you. Who told you that you were naked? Which means that Adam had a form of consciousness by which no matter how exposed he was, it did not affect his emotions. Which means there was now a new intellect. Y'all come on with me. There, the intellect is actually, if you know, we were in the breakdown with the intellect is, it's your logic. And a lot of what we consider our logic, come on somebody, has been given to us by the world. So now I go back over to Romans 12 and 2, and it's making a lot of sense now, because the Bible says don't be conformed to this world. The world teaches you cancel culture. The world teaches you you're not good enough, and you can't have a certain kind of spouse unless you got a certain kind of education. You can't have a certain kind of spouse unless you got a certain kind of size, and you better not have ever had a bad relationship. You better not have ever messed up in a relationship or messed up with a business. They come up with logic like credit. They come up with logic like if you're good enough. And they put a shame on you. They put you in a state of mind by which now you are running away for God's purpose for your life. Can I preach to you just a little bit? You don't need the degree to become what God called you to be unless he tells you to get the degree. Come on, somebody. I found out that you could have had five husbands. Come on, somebody, and still be the one at the well. Come on, woman at the well, by which God say, I came to talk to you, and I still want to give you something by which you will never thirst again. You can be a harlot and still on my staff. Y'all not hearing me right now. I'm here to tell you that you could be bankrupt several times over, but God can raise you back up and make you a financial genius. I'm just giving you some ideas about how we put our own limitations on our life because our state of mind is skewing our intellect. I got five babies. Who wants somebody with five babies? You never know. Matter of fact, if that man take you with five babies, you know he love you. Come on, somebody. You got a love that you probably ain't got to worry about. Come on, somebody. Amen. Well, Pastor, I'm broke right now, and I just don't feel like I can date anybody. I don't even feel like I need to be getting married right now. I got to get my finances together. Well, let me tell you, your finances will never get together because you will end up being distracted in life, chasing down somebody that don't even deserve your kind of love. Y'all better hear me right now. In other words, I would rather have a woman, come on now, that I meet while I'm broke. Come on, somebody, so I'll know why she's really with me. Sometimes you really don't know what you got because you're too busy playing the shame game. Thank God when that woman stick with you when you ain't got nothing. Thank God that you got members that'll still cheer you on when you made mistakes. Sometimes you really don't know who you really are until you hit rock bottom and you find out that rock bottom does not define you, but God does. So he says, who told you that something was wrong with you? can I go over here to this camera? Y'all gonna hit me up. Who told you that something was wrong with you? I like what it says in the next passage. He says, he leads me on the paths of righteousness, not for my name, but for his name's sake. Which means God is saying, Adam, my name is on the line because I made you in my image. And right now, this image seems to be tarnished. So it's up to me to restore it. The intellect. And so now we see Jesus in the same boat. The Bible said they stripped him naked. This is really why Jesus had to go to the cross. He couldn't die a normal kind of death. He had to die a certain kind of death so he could deal with this negative thing called shame. Lord have mercy. The Bible said they hung him high, they stretched him wide. Come on, somebody. But they hung him up on the cross naked as an act of shame. They defiled his whole ministry. They got his homeboy to betray him. They got another homeboy to deny him. They decimated his whole ministry. And it had to happen because Jesus had to feel what you feel. So he could empathize with you, so that he could give intercession for you. So when he went to go to the Father on your behalf, he could tell the Father, I know how it feels to be shamed. I now know why Adam ran away. But now I got to teach them how to handle the shame. Turn over here to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12. This young man preaching. Hebrews chapter 12. Tonight we got to start with this. And it's from here that you're getting ready to find yourself being fully restored. It's from here that you're going to pick yourself up again. It's from here that you're going to count it all joy. It's from here that you're going to look at your life and all the mistakes that you made, and you say, I can't move forward and keep looking back. I know what happened to me. I know I messed up, but who told me that I still can't achieve and be what God called me to be? I'm talking to the church tonight. Yeah, we acted a fool in 2020 with all this strife and all this politics, talking about this and talking about that. We embarrassed ourselves to the whole world. But God say, I'm getting ready to restore the glory because my name is on the line. And I told y'all that the former or the latter has to be greater than the former. The glory of the latter house has to be greater. We got to come out better than what we was before we started. You need to praise God right now. You don't need to get in fear. You don't need to run from your calling. Prophesy again. Lay hands on the sick again. Preach the word with gladness. Preach the word with boldness, because God say, I'm not finished with you because I'm married to the backslider. You are mine forever and ever. Somebody put up on the screen, restore. So this is what Jesus did. Watch his intellect. Watch his logic. And the Bible says, looking unto Jesus, number 2, Hebrews 12 and 2, looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. In other words, it's what I focus on. Come on, somebody. I say, it's what I focus on. In other words, if I focus on me, if I focus on my insufficiency, I'm not going to ever make it out. I need to find somebody who went through embarrassment that I have never, could never even imagine going through, and he still came out on top. He says, looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that's an emotion. Come on, somebody. Who the joy that was set before him. Amen. The Bible said he endured the cross, and look what he did to the shame. The Bible said, in despising the shame. In other words, despising means I'm not going to allow the way I feel right now to be the deciding factor of my life. When you honor something, you lift it up. When you despise it, you bring it down. I'm here to tell you that you need to take every mistake you ever made in your life and put it up under your feet. Put it in the trash. And when God put it in the trash, don't you go jumping in the dumpster. Leave it right where God left it. He says, I separate your sins as far as the east is from the west. I'm not worried about what you did in 2020. He says, I need you to despise the shame. Why? Because there's some joy waiting on you. Run to the joy. Put that up on the screen. Run to the joy. Because joy is a powerful emotion. That's why he says over in Nehemiah that the joy of the Lord is your strength. That's why he says over in Ephesians chapter 6, he said, be strong in the Lord, not yourself, not in your intellect, not in what you think, but be strong in the Lord, in the power of his might. So let's look at Nehemiah 8 for the sake of time. The prophet got up and he told the people of God how bad they had been, how they had forsaken God, how they had displeased God, and almost to a point to where he's looking at them like, you should be ashamed of yourself. And so they went into their traditional rituals of shame. And they pull out their sackcloth and they begin to pull on their hair and they begin to go into this form of emotion, an emotional state by which God can't help you. And so the prophet called them and said, don't y'all do that. The only way y'all gonna come out of this, you already been in captivity. You already been beat down. You've already been oppressed. You already made a mistake. I know you're sorry. Don't perpetuate it. But he said, go eat, drink, and be merry, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. You can't talk to traditional church folk about how throwing a party is actually something spiritual, but they'll quote that scripture all day. In other words, you might just need to throw yourself a coming out party. Ah, y'all better hear me. You might need to go to Walmart or Kroger or Brookshire and get you some cake and some ice cream and say, this is the last time I shed a tear over my mistake. This is the last time I stay in a state of shame and rolling the cover over my head and acting like I got a scarlet letter on my body. I'm coming out! And I'm getting ready to throw a coming out party. Everybody else is coming out the closet. It's time for you to come out the closet. Why are you ashamed of being a Christian? Because the world is mocking. The Bible said, whoever wants to live godly must suffer persecution. They gonna talk about you. They gonna laugh. But Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, but it's the power of God to get me out of my mess. I know it don't make sense that even though I'm a sinner, God has made me righteous. I know it don't make sense that God will use somebody like me, but he's going to, because he said it. So now we're looking at scripture and in life in a totally different way, by which I need to get my joy back. It may be hard to do, but you gotta find a way to do it. Sometimes it don't all come at once, but you might need to take some baby steps. Because resentment and shame and guilt, it affects your health. And that cancer in your body is being perpetuated. That strife is bringing down your immune system. And so you might not need to go into tongues right now, but you might just need to put on a funny movement. Oh yeah, I'm sounding like a heretic to a lot of y'all, but listen, I know this word. I've been there. I've done that. I got the hat and the t-shirt. I suffered from depression my whole life. Has been about people making fun of me, people looking over me, people trying to put me in a place, people oppressing me and lying on me and trying to put me to shame. But I had this mindset that all as well. The kingdom of God, according to Romans 14 and 17, is righteousness, peace, and joy. There's something about peace, if you really look at this word up in the Hebrew, when you look it up, and again, you know, God talked to the Hebrew people, so they had a certain kind of language to help us to understand God. That word peace comes from the word shalom, which means there's nothing missing, y'all better get this, nothing lacking. In other words, when I'm at peace, then I'm actually in a state by which I say there's nothing wrong. Adam was buck naked before he ate of the tree. Then all of a sudden he found something wrong, which lets me know that something could, according to my old intellect, could really be wrong. But when I'm in a state of peace, peace is like a thermostat. Once I set it, when I make up my mind, I'm going to be anxious for nothing. I'm not going to worry about it. I'm giving it to God. I'm going to be still. I'm in a place where I can say all is well, even though all hell is breaking out around me. So what happens when all is well? I'm not praying and seeking God because something is wrong. I'm praying and I'm seeking God because something is right. I am the righteousness of God. I'm back on the right track. I need to celebrate like I'm back on the right track. I need to praise God like I'm back on the right track. I slept with the wrong person last night, but I don't worship God because of who I am. I praise him because of who he is. And if you learn how to praise God while you're in the pit, he's going to bring you out. So now I got on my little movie, like all is well. I'm looking at houses online with messed up credit, like all is well. I'm looking for business partners when I really don't even know how I'm going to get my business off the ground, but I'm acting from a state of mind that all is well. I'm coming back to church on Sunday because I'm coming to church like all is well. I'm getting ready to date again. I'm getting ready to look for a wife again. I'm getting ready to be accepted by a man again, because now I'm not dating for survival. I'm dating like all is well. I feel like preaching right now because God says, I'm about to restore you to your original purpose of why I put you on this planet. And I didn't put you on this planet to run from me. I didn't put you on this planet to live a life of regret. I put you on this planet. Hallelujah. Oh, my God, for my glory. Listen to the prophet. God is about to be glorified in your life again. Your marriage is going to bring glory to God. Your finances are going to bring glory to God. Your health is going to bring glory to God. Your situation is going to bring glory to God because you're in a mindset of all is well. My intellect can't wrap around it right now, but if God said it, then I'm not going to exalt myself above his word. I'm not going to exalt my intellect above his word, lest I be put back into shame. I'm coming out because all is well. Well, Pastor, what's going on in D.C.? That's not your problem. All is well. Oh, yes, a woman lost her baby, and she was going to the prophet, and everybody was trying to point out to her, we heard, girl, we heard. They were trying to put her back in the same position that Adam was in, but she didn't go by what they heard. She didn't go by what they said. Only words that came out of her mouth, these three words, all is well. It is well. It is well with my So tonight when we take communion, we're going to take it with joy. But Pastor, what they said, that's the shame game. Well, Pastor, I don't feel worthy. That's the shame game. If God has made you worthy, don't you dare exalt yourself above what he said. Come under what he said tonight and watch the restoration take place. So Jesus told him, do this always in remembrance of me. Because you're probably going to make a mistake. And the devil wants you to go back under your rock. He wants you to run from him. But then you remember Hebrews 12 says, I need to look at him. I need to look at him. This is his body broken for you. I need to look at him. So tonight I want you to search your heart. And in any way that you have been going and running from your call, running from your purpose, running from the faith, running from what God has called you to, I want you to repent. Turn. It's changing mind. We thought repentance was, oh, I feel so bad. No, repentance is changing your mind. God is about correction, not punishment. Once you correct it, there's nothing else that needs to be corrected. So get your communion. And as you repent, I want you to go ahead and get your tithes and offerings together. Hallelujah. Repent of having the wrong priority concerning your finances. Repent of not trusting God. Repent of not leaning on him. You ain't got to be ashamed. We've all been there. I know I was crunk tonight, but this is how God told me to start out this series. The devil don't hold back with his shame. Oh, he real quiet. He go gathers people together to make fun of you. He gathers people together to point out your mistakes. And so tonight I want you to gather as many people together. And I want you to have the same attitude that Micah had when he said, don't you rejoice over me too early, my enemy. For I shall arise. Partake of the body that's been broken for you. This blood was an atonement for all your mistakes. This blood is a witness to the truth that all is well. Oh my God, this series is going to be good. Take of the blood of the Lord Jesus. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this word on tonight. And just like the prodigal son that got away from you, the Bible said he came to himself. Restoration was waiting on him. But it's when he changed his mind and he swallowed his pride, he ran home and he got restored better than what he was before he left. Thank you for this word on tonight. Thank you for the shift on tonight. Right now, I rebuke the accuser of the brethren. You've already lost, and they've already won. So Jesus, our high priest, I ask you to worship the Father in heaven with the tithes and offering that he may pour out a blessing that we have not room enough to receive. Father, I ask you to cause your face to shine upon these wonderful people. Be gracious unto them and give them peace. I say blessings flow to them easily and frequently. Teach us how to despise our mistakes. We learn from them, but we don't bring ourselves into a state of defeat. We always win. Thanks be to God. In Jesus' name, amen. I love y'all. See you next time. Peace. Okay.
was running with the